passed along the way. Well, I got down on my knees, and I began to pray. You hear the preacher like the call. He knows I'm gonna stay.
Hello again, I'm Mike and I'm a sports history collector. Today we have a special Veterans Day edition of Athletes at War. This is volume 23 featuring baseball's Al Bumbry. And although in the past I've featured athletes from World War I, World War II, and the Korean War, this is the first time to feature one from the Vietnam War. I hope you'll stick around till the end for an interesting interview with Mr. Bumbry. The following are excerpts from an article from Birdland Insider by Bill Stetka. Al Bumbry signed with the Orioles in 1968 and was in the majors 4 years later, but it was not a smooth nor a regular ascent through the minors that got him there, nor would keep him there for the next 14 big league seasons. Bumbry spent his first 13 years in the majors with the Orioles, winning American League Rookie of the Year award in 1973, becoming the first Oriole to record 200 hits in a season, ranking among the club's leaders in numerous offensive categories, and helping win two American League pennants and a World Series championship. But Bumbry's ascent to become an Orioles Hall of Fame member did not grow out of what he learned in college or in the minors. It came from the duty and responsibility he learned during the Vietnam War, serving in the U.S. Army as a tank platoon leader. Bumbry was an ROTC student and basketball player at Virginia State and didn't play baseball until his senior year when he batted .578 and was drafted by the Orioles. He played just 35 games for the Orioles Class A Stockton farm team in 1969, batting just .171 before being called to active duty in the U.S. Army. As a second lieutenant, he spent a year at Fort Meade near Baltimore before being sent to Vietnam as a tank platoon leader. He spent 11 months in Vietnam in charge of the safety of 9 vehicles and 45 men. As a platoon leader, I was responsible not only for my life, but for men in my platoon, Bumbry said. We had to go out into the jungle in Vietnam, and I remember my commander telling me, "The war was going on before you got here, and it'll be going long after you leave. Your main objective is to see that you and your men get home safely. You can't neglect your responsibilities, but your main objective was to get yourself and your men home safely." I always kept that in the back of my mind, Bumbry said. Now, the life expectancy of a lieutenant and second lieutenant, and this varies depending on where you look, was somewhere between 20 minutes and 2 weeks. Kind of bleak, if you ask me. The reasons ranged from inexperience to being fragged. For those of you too young to know, fragging was when a member of or members of a platoon felt like the commander was taking an unneeded risk with their lives and were going to needlessly get them killed. They would take a grenade and throw it into the commander's tent or wherever he was at the time. Since Al Bumbry made it 11 months with his platoon, almost entirely out in the field, and that he only lost one man at that time, says a lot about the man himself and what his men thought about him. Once, his platoon intercepted a large shipment of supplies heading for the Viet Cong military. For that, he was awarded a Bronze Star. After his tour was up, between his dismal batting average and his brief stint in the minors and his nearly 2 years in the service, Bumbry wasn't sure that he would be able to become a baseball player. But he knew one thing. His time in the military, and particularly in Vietnam, had taught him an invaluable life lesson. Being responsible for other lives, I think it made me focus more. I'm sure it changed me, he said. When he returned in 1971, he batted .336 for the Orioles farm team in Aberdeen, South Dakota. The next season, he batted .345 between AA Asheville and AAA Rochester before earning a September call-up to the Orioles. He earned the AL Rookie of the Year award in 1973 and finished out his 14-year career in 1985 with a .281 batting average with 1,422 hits and 254 stolen bases. Al Bumbry, we thank you for your service. And now for a couple tidbits. Bumbry was told prior to being shipped to Vietnam that he and his platoon would spend the first 6 months in the rear of the action to learn the ropes. So it came as quite a surprise as they were actually sent out into the fighting the day after they arrived and remained there the entire time. Welcome to the Army, boys. After his tour was up, Bumbry was offered a promotion to captain if he re-upped for another 2 years. Al politely declined, citing a desire to try to see if he could make the major leagues. A wise career decision, as it obviously affected his life expectancy, since Al Bumbry is still alive today. And now for my collection, a beautiful signed 1984 Topps card of Al Bumbry. Always loved the 84 cards, and this one was has a perfectly placed black Sharpie signature, and is one I'll look on fondly over the years to come. Well, I hope you enjoyed this special Veteran Day edition of Athletes at War featuring Al Bumbry, and I'll talk to you soon.
Tell us about the military and how you got involved, you know, in the service. I know you were a platoon leader in Vietnam, but tell us the timeline of how that started out and, you know, and when you got it, maybe more so into the baseball at the end or whatever.
Well, basically, you know, my association with the military, it came about because I went to a state-supported school, which is Virginia State College, and your first 2 years there, you were required to take the ROTC program. So I took it for, and you got a deferment from being drafted.
Okay.
And in 64, when I went there, needless to say, the Vietnam War was in full swing. And guys were getting drafted, you know, from all over the country. And people were, you know, defecting, so to speak, to Canada because they didn't want to go in the service, primarily because of the Vietnam War and its unpopularity. And when I finished the first 2 years, those requirements were over. And for the next 2 years, I did not have a deferred status.
Okay.
And I was eligible for the draft. And sure enough, during the summer, after my sophomore year, I got my orders to come down to the draft board and get tested or whatever. And I went there and I got classified, you know, 1A, which is the primary draft classification. So hell, I don't want to go in a war just like that, just like a lot of people. I'm not going to defect to Canada, but I don't want to go into the war. So, oh, okay. I go back to college, and if you join the advanced ROT course, which gave you 2 more years of deferment from the Army. However, when you graduated and got your degree, you had to take an oath to become an officer. And you raise your right hand, you take the oath of office, you know, and I think about it a lot, you know, well, over the last 2 years, you know, when I know the presidents and the congresspeople, all they take the oath of office to defend the Constitution, et cetera. Well, as an officer and an enlisted person, you raise your right hand and you swear to uphold the Constitution, et cetera. So I said, okay, I'll join the ROTC program for 2 more years because I wanted to continue to play basketball and I didn't want to get drafted. If I do this, I'll get a deferment for 2 more years, plus I'll get paid $50 a month. Yeah, $50 a month for taking a class, whatever. So that's what I did. And after those 2 years were up, I had to go and raise my right hand, took the oath of office, and I got my commission as a second lieutenant, went on active duty at Fort Meade for a year, and then I went to Vietnam for the second year. So that was my initial entrance into the military, and of course, even up until the time I raised my right hand, and when I was stateside at Fort Meade, came up to a couple of oil games, I still wasn't convinced that I was going to get orders to go to Vietnam. But as it turned out, that second year, I got my orders to go, and my commitment was 2 years of active duty, 2 years inactive duty, 2 years reserve, and then 2 years of inactive duty. So I had 6 year commitment. And I got orders to go to Vietnam, and I was there for a year. And then when I ETS'd out of the military after 2 years, that's when I came back and started to play baseball.
Platoon leader.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Well, obviously, the Vietnam War was still going on, and they needed officers. And my second year, I got orders to go to Vietnam, and the policy then was, if you're a new lieutenant coming to Vietnam, you're going to be there for a year. So they typically try to have you stay back in the rear, so to speak, in terms of that, and not being out in the jungles to acclimate yourself, to learn the tricks of the trade, to learn the ropes, etc. But when I got there, and a couple other lieutenants that were in my same class, not from the same school, But we arrived there and they said, we need lieutenants out in the field. So boom, they threw us on a truck the next day and off we went, right out into the jungles, right into the fire. Okay, all right. And I know the captain, my captain, or our captain, you know, there were three platoons, A, B, and C, I think. And I had A, I believe, and the other two guys had B and C. And captain called us in his office and he said, listen, gentlemen, you know, real stern, I'm just standing, I'm shaking like this. You're going to be here for a year. I want you to perform your duties as an officer, as a second lieutenant. You're going to have, I think, was 48 men in your platoon. Your main objective should be, because this war was going on before you got here, and it will be going on after your term is up. Your main objective should be, number one, to do your responsibility in terms of your job description and what we order you to do. Or secondary to that would be to make sure that you and your men get back home. So the whole time I was there, those were the two rules that I operated under. You know, do my job and make sure I took care of myself and my men and see that we got back home. I think I lost, you know, one man in my platoon in those 11 months I was there.
A lot of people don't even want to talk about, you know, being in the service or anything like that. Is it difficult for you to go back and remember this?
Well, I've loosened up over the last 15, 20 years. But when I first came back, I didn't talk about it.
Yeah.
You know, and no one pressed me on it. Even the guys on the team, they didn't press me on it. Every now and then, if I were one-on-one with somebody, they asked me a question I might answer, but never in a group form. And I never talked about the, you know, Vietnam and my experiences there very often. But I've loosened up some over the years and I've learned to do it more now, but for the most part, no, I don't.